Welcome to the Wally Show Aftercast. A little bit different today. We're going to give you the whole conversation that we had with Matthew West. We didn't air hardly any of it. We just scratched the surface of it, but it's really good. And so hopefully you'll get something out of it. There's some funny stuff, some serious stuff. And if you want to see the whole thing, because we actually videoed it as well, and Gavin's got it all cut up, all you have to do is text the word pizza, P-I-Z-Z-A, to 91979. Then you can enjoy the visuals that go along with it as well. And as always, thanks for being a potty.
Dude, good idea.
There's nobody that does this like you. Nobody.
Oh, it's like saying, like, dude, nobody cleans toilets as good as you. Dude, nobody makes up stupid songs.
I've made my life on stupid songs, man. Like, that's my that's what I've done for so many years.
I was at this festival, and every year it's like a tradition where they expect me to make up a new song for them.
Right, right.
A lot of times they expect me to play the one I made up the year before, and I'm like, you guys don't understand. Like, these go out into the abyss.
Yeah, never to be remembered again.
That's the point of it. It's just off the cuff. And so, the whole day, every volunteer I see, they're like, you got the song? And I'm like, no, I don't. And so I get up on stage, and whatever hits me,
really?
And I just start singing.
What a skill, though. What a gift.
Well, I mean, but in this festival in Wisconsin, 10,000 people, and it's packed, and they're all waiting for the original song. So for some reason, I rhymed something with, deodorant. Mm. Like they forgot, because the pit is in front of you, and it's just thousands of kids.
Yeah.
And I went out into the crowd before then, and I was like, man, this place, like, you guys, somebody forgot, something forgot, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, came and went. Apparently, some of you forgot deodorant or whatever.
Nice.
And as I continue singing, I get hit by a bottle of deodorant.
No!
Some girl throws her deodorant on the stage, and then another person throws their deodorant.
That's
like,
so funny.
They had brought their deodorant with them. I guess they're all camping at this thing. And so I start getting hit with bottles little things
None
of deodorant.
None of them hit you in the face or anything,
but that's been a trend lately.
You're like Harry Styles.
I know. So I got it just hit my leg.
I know. I'm just like Harry Styles.
I'm just like Harry style, minus the women's clothing. But held the deodorant up, and the crowd just went wild for deodorant. It was just like, it's like one of those you had to be there.
Yeah.
Like, it was almost like you're at church camp or something.
Yeah. Well, I know you said deodorant is one of the subjects. What were other subjects from songs in the past?
Oh, I mean, well, that particular festival, one year I was performing and a storm broke out, a storm hit, and the whole band started getting soaked and all the equipment started to go down. So the one by one, the crew was moving the band off to stage until it was just me by myself, and the rain's coming down, and I'm like, I'm not leaving. Are you guys leaving? And
then
I start cheering. So I'm standing there by myself. It was like this epic, this feels like kind of a rock and roll moment.
At that point, were you wishing you had an electric guitar and not an acoustic guitar to make it cooler?
Plus my acoustic guitar is getting absolutely ruined.
Yeah,
I wish I had an electric. So the rain hits, and I said something into the mic. I was like, is that all you got, devil? And then literally my guitar stops working.
No.
And so then I put my guitar down and started singing a cappella, and the crowd that night I made up a song about soggy bottom Christians or something.
Nice.
And for 5 years after, all the people come to they're like, hey, we were the soggy bottom Christians.
That's
like,
so funny.
You just never know.
Dude,
we had
years ago, we had Aaron Schust on.
Yeah.
And I said, I want to write a song about, the tough verses in the Bible. So I gave him the one where Elijah calls down the bears to maul the 42 kids. So he writes this song, and the lyric was great. He's like, and call him down to maul all 32 like Elijah do. And so he does this. It's just kind of off the cuff and funny. Years later, I run back into him, and he goes, I was at the airport or the tire store. I can't remember what it was. And he goes, this guy goes, hey, aren't you Aaron Schust? The singer guy goes, yeah. He goes, man, I love your music and that song. And he goes, oh, my savior, my God. He goes, no, the one about the bears.
Send your bears. Send them out of the woods and maul all 42 like Elijah do.
Oh,
man.
That is what this guy knew him and remembered him from. It's like the stupid stuff lands,
hey,
man.
Well, I can't tell you how many times I've been, you know, stopped and reminded of stuff you've had me do on the show over the years. Like, and you're exactly right. It's like sometimes, like, you know, I think so many times, and we've talked about this, but it's like in Christian music, we can, like, we take any artist. Anybody who's so precious about their art can really sometimes take themselves too seriously,
for sure.
too. And so, like, I love the disarming nature of a funny moment in a show. I like the, it's almost just like that's always been, to be honest with you, to kind of let you see inside, like, some of my personal mission statements. This is no joke, but, like, I years ago kind of landed on this word, like, if I had to boil down what's my mission when I get on stage, like, in one word, the word, or with my whole career in ministry, was connect.
Yeah.
Connecting to the hearts of people and then connecting them to the heart of God, right? But how do I do that? How has God uniquely gifted me to do that? And you can relate to this because you're very similar in this. It's two words, humor and heart.
Absolutely.
And it was like, and that, when I tapped into that and realized, hey, you know, just because someone maybe doesn't think it's cool for me to be funny. And years ago, it was like pressure to always be like a brooding rock star.
Right, right.
That was the thing. They wanted you to be like, who, how do we figure him out? And it's like, that's never been who I am. So it's, you know, it goes to show when you kind of get more comfortable with how God's wired you and step into that unapologetically, beautiful things happen. Mm-hmm. And so humor and heart have always been like the components that go into my platform, and it's very intentional.
See, that's, we call that in radio, we call it the filter. Like, what is your filter? What do you filter everything through? And for us, it's the same two words.
I was going to say, don't you feel,
says humor and heart on it.
Do you seriously?
Yeah, absolutely.
You have that t-shirt?
I have a t-shirt. It says The Wally Show, and it says humor and heart, and that's the reason.
That's not your tagline, is it?
For that shirt, it was.
Holy cow. How did I not know that?
Well, we're going to sue you now.
yeah. No, but, like, that was because the humor is what, like, brings people in, and it connects you to them. And it's healing. God uses that stuff, dude. I have so many stories of people saying, man, you made me laugh on the worst day. And then when the God stuff comes in, the heart comes in.
Absolutely,
it stands out because it's not just, it hasn't all just been God stuff to where it now it doesn't mean anything.
That's,
you know?
It. I feel like we're kindred spirits in that. Like, that doesn't surprise me that you had a t-shirt that says humor and heart, because that's exactly, like, and every time I come in,
it's always
like,
easy.
I know we're going to have an element of, you know, both, and not be afraid to just have some fun as well. But you're exactly right. It's like when you step into somebody's life, like, you're stepping into their story. And, like, every night when I get on stage, I take a moment to thank the audience for letting me, hey, thank you for letting my songs step into your story. And then tonight at this show, or even on this interview, like, we're literally stepping into somebody's story, and like, somebody may be having an awful day. And
absolutely.
So for the chance to them, you know, to have a laugh in the middle of a day where it's filled with a lot more tears, like, that's a beautiful thing. And, you know, that's, and what does the Bible talk about the importance of laughter? It does good like a medicine.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what I've tried to, Betty Rock started with me 16 years ago, and she had, like, zero experience and stuff like that. Gavin's only got 4 years in this. And the thing that I always tried to instill in them is that the people who give you this opportunity, always treat them well. Like, you know, the ones that deserve it. Some are crazy. but go that extra mile for people and spend that extra time. Do that extra minute that it takes to, you know, shake the last hand on your way out of a show, because it matters to them. They remember that
stuff.
Well,
and we have to do it because he won't.
Yeah, exactly.
So he's in the limousine.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like, go out there and be the ministry.
He's already on the helicopter.
Yeah. Okay, Wally, thanks.
That's
buddy.
How I roll. Now, I've seen you doing stuff with your daughter recently. Oh. And so, like, you guys have been singing. She's been on stage with you.
Well, you know what
and
she
Lulu,
did?
Like, she's, like, what, 15 now?
No. Dude, now you're going to make me cry. She's already 17.
No!
Yeah, she's going into her senior year of high school.
Oh, wow. My goodness.
It's, in fact, I just, we're planning my fall tour, and we have it all planned, and we just found out, like, the date of senior night, and so I had to call the whole team and say, hey, this show in whatever, North Carolina, has to be moved to another date, because I can't miss senior night.
You can't.
Right? So it's like,
you're a better father than me.
Oh.
I probably would have missed it.
No, dude. It's like, I don't get another senior
night. Good
for you. So she's 17, but you know what she did? She took a song from my record. She went to my team and said, hey, I've got this idea. There's a song I wrote called Before You Ask Her. And it's basically a song for any boys who are going to ring the doorbell at the West House. And it's just like, basically, you know, I got some questions for you. You need to ask yourself before you ask her, right?
Right.
And it's kind of like, you know, a newer Butterfly Kisses.
Hopefully, you know what, that's a good one, because yeah. I always send the Rodney Atkins song Cleaning My Gun to the boyfriend.
This is that, but less violence.
Okay, good. Okay, that's a good idea.
So she took the song, and she said, I want to go back in the studio and surprise my dad for Father's Day and record a new version where I sing the harmonies.
Oh, nice.
And so they surprised me and played me this version. The label heard it, and they all made a plan without me knowing to put the song out on Father's Day.
Will you hold the door, be polite, pick up the tab and treat her right?
Nice.
And then Fox News heard it and invited us to New York to sing it on national television on Father's Day.
Yes, oh, I saw that.
It's so much. I'm like, so she was surprising me, and the next day I go, hey, you want a surprise? Like, how do you feel about going to New York?
Yeah.
And so we went to New York, had an epic time. Like, we hadn't been to New York since before the pandemic.
Right.
And it was like, so we went as a family and ate amazing food. And I will say, like, the streets of New York feel a little different than, that's another topic, but it was a different vibe.
Are you okay with your daughter, like, trying to get a little bit into the music business or no?
I'm not encouraging it, but I'm not discouraging it. And honestly, I don't think she wants to be like in front of the camera.
Really?
Like, I think she has a really nice voice, but I think she's kind of more interested in like the music industry side of things.
She kind of wants to be like a cool radio guy.
That's it. I think she does have a Wally poster.
Why can't you be my dad?
If I had a dime for every time I've heard her say it. But I don't know what she's going to do yet, but she's definitely talented. And so when she comes on the road with me now, like, she'll hop on stage and sing.
That's fun.
That's really special.
Yeah, that's really fun. That's I love that. Recently, we Betty Rock and I were at a radio industry event, and they have a bunch of Christian artists that come out there, and Matthew was one of them. And you had told a story that I had never heard before. About, because I knew you had a song with Scotty McCreery years ago that you wrote, country song. You're a prolific writer, so you write multiple songs, different genres. But you had thought seriously about like jumping in and writing more country songs, right?
I had. I had a song recorded. It was actually a song I wrote for my wife. So I just sat down and wrote it by myself.
Yes, do the dishes. No, that was a good one.
What?
Yes. It was called.
No.
Yeah, it was called "Honey, Fix Me a Chicken Pot Pie."
Oh my lord! No wonder you didn't make it in the country music business.
It was called "Baby, Where's the Meatloaf?" Like, let's go,
Ma. The meatloaf.
No, it was a song I wrote called "The Day Before You" that, like, out of the blue, Rascal Flatts, when they were like blowing up, heard it and recorded it, and like, it went on, their album went on and sold like 7 million albums. And I was like, what in the world just happened? And I was like, is this that easy? Like, I could just write songs for country singers too. And so what was interesting was, I think a lot of times there's always a struggle internally where it's like God's call on your life and then like the plans that you want to try to make because you think maybe you know better.
And like a Range Rover.
There you exactly.
Two
exactly.
Of them.
So I was at a point with my like artistry where I think I was just feeling like I was hitting my head against the ceiling, maybe just frustrated. And meanwhile, I was having the country industry kind of come to me and say, hey, we actually think, you know, you've got a bright future as a top country songwriter. And the thought of like, wait, so I wouldn't go on tour. I would just stay home, drink coffee every day, write songs, maybe have a healthier life because I'm home with my family all the time, whatever. And it started to tickle my ears. And so much so that I actually went and signed a songwriting contract with a country publishing company under the understanding that I was going to focus and shift my focus to be a full-time country songwriter.
Because what I don't think people understand the difference between having a number one country song as a writer and a number one Christian song as a writer, it is vastly different. I mean, it literally is between buying a couple Range Rovers or buying a go-kart. That's the difference.
And that's not an exaggeration.
No.
Yeah, you should see the go-kart I have.
It's nice.
I've been very fortunate in Christian music. I got a nice go-kart, though. Yeah, the best one they had.
Oh, yeah, it has a horn.
It has a horn, and the helmet is super shiny. Yeah,
yeah, but no. But you can make so much more money.
Yeah, I mean, well, country music is just such a wider reaching genre, right? Mm-hmm. And so the more radio stations, the more royalties, the more everything. So yeah, it is literally a kind of a 10 to 1 sort of thing. And you know, you can, anybody's like susceptible of being driven by the wrong things as well. And so for me, it was one of those things where I was just like, hey, maybe that's something I want to do. And I went and I literally signed that contract. Like, I'm not saying I got to the signing and then like put the pen down and walked away. No, I went through with it. Mm-hmm. And then I had a very profound moment where I felt like, I don't always talk about like God speaking to me in an audible voice. That's never happened. But I felt like very clearly God speaking to me in a unique way, saying, Matthew, you've released yourself from something that I have not released you from yet. Mm-hmm. And that was like your ministry as an artist, as a Christian, as getting up on stage and telling people about Jesus. Like, you what are you doing? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I wasn't necessarily going to walk away from it entirely, but I was shifting my priorities mentally and preparing to do so. And so I literally walked back into that office weeks after signing that contract and sat down with the head of the company. And I said, look, I know I told you what my shifting focus was going to be, and thank you for believing in me that I could do that, but I just need to tell you, and this particular person didn't necessarily share the same faith as me even, so I was nervous about how do I communicate this in a way that's like, when I'm talking about things like calling,
right?
You know, and I just, and so I just laid it out plainly, and they said, you know what? We believe in you, whatever you want to do. We're going to champion whatever it is that you feel called to do. And so I walked out of there and I went and I wound up writing Hello, My Name Is. And I wound up writing Strong Enough. And I wound up collecting people's stories. And that like began a whole new like excitement and passion for ministry and songs about Jesus that help reach into people's stories and, you know, give them some hope. So it was kind of like, and it was one of those things where like God was showing me, like, you see, like when you honor what I, when you step into my calling for your life, it's always going to be better.
Well, and two, I think, and Wally's done the whole radio business outside of Christian music.
Oh, yeah. That's how I started.
Yeah.
I started in country radio. And so.
Go figure, right?
I thought I'd fit right in.
You do.
But maybe you felt this way too. To me, I quit country radio because to me there wasn't as big of a calling. Like I felt like there, like you go in. I love the music. I love like 90s country it's at.
I actually grew up on country music.
Me too.
Yeah,
I knew country more than I did Christian. I didn't know the difference between Stephen Curtis Chapman and Michael W. Smith. I couldn't tell you.
Okay.
Sometimes I still have a problem.
The worst was when she confused Michael W. Smith and George Michael one day.
That's unacceptable.
That really did happen, actually.
That's where we need a song about forgiveness.
Yeah. But all that to say, like when I got into Way FM, it was more like there's something bigger than me, and I felt like there was more of a
purpose.
Yeah, there was a purpose behind
without
it instead
question.
Of the country side of things.
And that's it. I mean, and that's hopefully a lesson for anybody even listening to this, that it's like, look, there's different measures of success that the world has, but fulfillment and success are two different things.
Absolutely,
right? And I mean, I'm telling you, man, when you step, I've never had, no offense to like the country songs I've written, but I've never had somebody, you know, come up to me and say, man, that song you wrote about summertime, like really like helped me through hard times.
Yeah. No,
but, and so I think there's just like, when you get a taste, it ruins you for ordinary. You know what I mean? And plus at the end of the day, there was a point where I was going to be sitting in rooms and like it kind of faced with this, like, do I want to write a song that actually like conflicts with who I am and what I believe too, you know what I mean? And so the crazy full circle of this whole story, guys, is that all these years later, I'm actually finding myself, when you, even if you deliberately walk away from something that you know God is not calling you to, it doesn't mean that he's not gonna have something returned to you.
Sure.
And so I'm in a place right now in my music making where like the rooms that I'm sitting in, like, it's, you'd be amazed. It's just like, now I'm sitting in the room with these incredible country writers or country artists, and they actually are saying, no, I listen to your records. Like,
that's cool.
So it's like, they're Christians, and now I'm getting a chance to actually write like faith driven country songs.
Nice.
And it's like, what is happening?
Yeah.
And it's just, to me, it's just proof that it's like, man, God's got a calling. Like Jeremiah 29:11, I know that we beat that scripture like into our heads, but like I don't think we do it enough because right. there's so much truth in that scripture to go, I know the plans I have for you. It clearly does not say you know. Mm-hmm. It says, I know.
And it's it doesn't like, even say, I'm going to tell you.
Exactly. What it does say is two verses later, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, okay, Lord, what does it look like for me to lay down my intentions and my plans, even if it sounds good, even if someone's promising the world, am I willing to walk away from that promise of the world in exchange for what you have for me? Because when I every time I've done that, it's always been better.
Yeah.
It's always been more fulfilling. It may not always be bigger. It may be a golf cart instead of the Range Rover.
Yeah.
But you know what?
But you're happier.
I got a big old smile in that in that what'd you say, golf cart or go-kart?
Go-kart.
Well, either one, man. I'm smiling.
See, a Christian artist can get a go-kart, a golf cart. A radio guy has to get a go-kart. We're further down the food
it's
chain.
It's pretty much a lawnmower.
Yeah. Or one of those scooters. Downtown
Nashville. Yes, exactly.
It's a bird scooter. Oh, yeah. Like I know when I like came here from mainstream radio, I had no idea what was going to happen. And the guy that hired me, he goes, I know you're taking a huge pay cut. Like I took a 2/3 pay cut to come here.
Because like you talked about the songwriting thing, like is it similar in on all parts of it? Like when you go to faith-based anything, it's like
he was at Radio Disney and made a lot.
Dude, I used to have $60,000 bonuses.
You were getting those Disney dollars.
Yes. I mean, like it was crazy money. And so like leaving that was hard, but then I'm like, okay, I really want to do this. And I got here, and I'm like, I don't know how I can do this, God. There's no way. And the guy that hired me, he goes, look, dude, he goes, I came from mainstream radio, too. He goes, I cannot tell you how, but I'm telling you, if you will do this, it will work out, and it will be better than you've ever thought.
Wow.
And I didn't believe him. And the first 3 years was brutal here, and I was going broke, like going living off my savings to keep doing this.
Wow.
And it was hard. And then it just kind of shifted, and I got happier about being here, and I enjoyed it. I felt that purpose. I felt that calling, and it cost me something. That's how I know it's God's will in my life, is when it cost me something to where I can't be selfish, you know? And I'm like, okay, I'm in. And he was so right. I've seen parts of the world I would have never seen before. I've seen poverty. I've seen joy. I've seen God in the midst of poverty, and it's been stuff that has been some of the highlights of my life that I would have missed out on.
And your show's impacted so many people's lives. And literally, like, this is a dark world that needs light. And, you know, I mean, that's where I do feel like, I always feel like there's this partnership that takes place. Like, ministries partnering together. The artist and the radio network, the radio station, that it's like, you guys, we're bringing you these songs that we feel like have a purpose, that are more, you know, and different songs can serve different purposes.
For
like
sure.
There's the entertainment, there's the feel good, but you know what I mean? It's like there's a different thing that happens. And when people connect with a song on your station, there's a deeper level of connection. And what we're talking about is the spiritual connection.
Exactly.
And so I just think it's so cool to go, it's like, hey, whatever lane God puts you in, because somebody else might go, well, gosh, I really wanted to be a pastor, but then God's call it on their life is actually to be in the business world.
Right.
It's like, it can be the flip side of that too. And it's going to like, you'll see, it's like wherever you're called to be in ministry, like go to that calling. Don't run from it. I know it sounds like such a simple teaching, but it's like go to where he's calling you, and wherever that is, you're going to find purpose and fulfillment.
I had a conversation with my wife a few years ago. I was kind of at that crossroads. I'm like, do I want to keep doing this? Like, do I want to just... Because I'd had some frustration things, and like business becomes business, and you sometimes forget the good in it, and you're only seeing the grass is greener.
Of course.
And I had thought, okay, I've got some opportunities. I could go back to mainstream radio. And I remember my wife going, she's going, you will be miserable.
Mm.
Like you, because you'll walk out of there and go, you did nothing today that truly mattered.
Mm.
You know, and she's like, because even on your worst day here, usually you're getting an email from somebody that was like, oh, that mattered to me. That was cool. I appreciate what you guys do. And it was such good counsel
from her. Wally,
You know, she's been the reason, like she's been the part of all the good decisions in my life.
Man, to have a truth teller in your life like that, who knows you, like it's funny. It's funny you say that. Like I was on the phone with my wife yesterday, and like I was going into a meeting that I was like kind of anxious about, right? Like, weirdly anxious about. And I just kind of...
Was that a 12-step thing?
Or? Yeah, yes, exactly, right. It was a meeting with ChatGPT. And I was just like, and I was telling her, I was like, and I just kind of opened up to her. I was like, man, I'm feeling weird about this. And she just said, she's like, look, this, and this. And like, she just told me the truth.
Yes.
And I was like, and afterwards, I just texted her. I was like, you put me at ease like very few people can, but just by telling me the truth, you know.
Well, you're lucky you only got one of those in your life.
Oh, you got a bunch of truth
tellers? I got two. I got my wife at home who's great with my personal life.
Oh, you
and
got
then
Betty.
I got Betty.
Yeah, you telling the truth?
Brutally honest.
Brutal Betty?
Yes.
Listen, sometimes he needs to hear it. Let's be honest.
Brutally honest.
He is so dramatic.
I'm not dramatic.
Ridiculous.
I'm not dramatic.
But he is the drama.
I'm not the drama.
He is.
No, I'm not the drama.
He
you're
is the drama.
Brutal. Little Betty, yeah. I like that.
Yeah, she is rough. But and there's like, I don't know if you're like me. You have to earn that right to speak truth to me.
Oh,
and,
for sure.
And like, because I know I'm not. If there's no relationship, you have no influence in my life.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But Betty, over time, has seriously earned my respect.
Worn him down.
She's worn.
Well,
she's
I would
earned
say
my respect.
16 years. Yeah. Like you don't work together that long without like building respect for each other.
Absolutely.
And appreciating their voice
at some point.
And I would agree
come.
With her that See? Yeah, you are drama.
I mean, drama. Just... I love the drama. I can't not have drama in my life.
Growing up in poverty has never been easy for children, but with the added challenges of the pandemic, conflict, and natural disasters, families around the world are facing an unprecedented food crisis. Unfortunately, those who are already hungry are now even more desperate. But by sponsoring a child through Compassion, you can help provide life-sustaining essentials such as food and clean water. And with your compassionate support, that child can not only survive, but also flourish. You can find out how and choose a child to sponsor when you click on the Compassion banner at wayfm.com.